So every year, Google comes out with a new iteration of Android OS. And along with the OS, you get to see a brand new Nexus device. This year, it's the Nexus 5. The Nexus 5 is kind of a canvas to show off what KitKat is capable of doing, but it goes far beyond that. It gets you top-of-the-line specs at a very reasonable price point. But at that price point, you do expect some kind of compromises. Let's take a look at how the Nexus 5 scores. My name is Rishabh, and you're watching Helpintosh. So the device is about 5.43 inches tall and 2.72 inches wide. And at about 0.34 inches, it's ever so slightly thinner than its predecessor. It's mainly thick at the center and tapers towards the edges. It also comes with Gorilla Glass 3, which Corning claims is 3 times more damage resistant than the Gorilla Glass 2, which we saw on the Nexus 4. On the top, you have a 1.3 megapixel front-facing camera and a speaker grille, which is white if you buy the white variant and black on the black one. And right beside that, you have a couple of sensors. The display is 4.95 inches long and has a resolution of 1080 x 1920 pixels, which comes up to a staggering 445 pixels per inch. But pixel density is not all that matters. I felt the colors were a little less saturated for my taste and the blacks looked a little washed out. But the images looked crisp and watching videos was quite enjoyable. The viewing angles were also quite comfortable and I had no difficulty using the phone under sunlight. I like how the notification light is implemented. It's quite minimalistic, just like the Nexus 4. It's there when you need it or it's not there at all. The speaker is a disappointment though. It's placed in such a position that you will tend to block it while holding the phone in landscape mode. I found myself holding the phone the other way around just to not block the speakers while playing games or while watching videos. Also, it's not as loud and tends to distort if you push the volume all the way up. Right next to the speaker, you have the micro USB port, which is slim port enabled, which means you can connect the device to your TV and play games or watch movies in full HD resolution. The phone does not recognize flash drives by default, but you could do this using an app like Total Command. But I had no problems using my wireless mouse, it worked perfectly well. On the right side of the charging port, what looks like a speaker grill is actually a dummy grill and only has a mic inside. On the back, you have the 8 megapixel camera and the LED flash. So let's take a look at the camera app as well and do some test shots. The app looks pretty similar to the one on Jelly Bean with an addition of HDR Plus mode. You can set your exposure and you have a couple of white balance settings to select from and also a few scene modes. Under good lighting conditions, the camera is quite quick to focus, but in low light situations, it takes quite a while and sometimes it won't focus at all. Also, quite a lot of times, the focusing ring will show focused when the shot is actually not in focus. I'm not sure if this has been fixed in the 4.4.2 update. I'll maybe do another video with a couple of tests. So let's take a look at the HDR mode. Though this won't be the optimal condition to do this kind of a test, but it should still give us a good idea. So this first picture I'm going to click with HDR mode on and the second one without it. On comparing both the images, I felt the one without HDR was a tad bit burnt out in the highlights, whereas the one with HDR retained a lot more details, but the color temperature was a little too warm for my liking. Apart from that, you have the same photosphere, panorama, and video modes that we saw on Jelly Bean. In the video mode, you have a couple of white balance settings again, and you can capture time-lapse recordings. You can notice that the lens tries hard to focus even while recording videos. The video quality at 1080p HD looks quite decent, but nothing to write home about. The 1.3 megapixel front-facing camera is quite good for making video calls. Now, the body is made out of a polycarbonate shell, which feels quite tough and has a nice matte texture to it. But the white model picks up stains really fast, especially if you're not using the case, and I found myself cleaning it every now and then. Now, looking at the internals, the phone is powered by a 2.2 GHz Snapdragon 800 processor with 2 GB of RAM. It comes with 16 or 32 GB of internal storage, depending on which variant you buy. And like any other Nexus device, it does not have a micro SD expansion slot. Apart from that, this is the first device to be tasting Android KitKat, which brings in a whole lot of new features. The user interface has been completely revamped and it looks much cleaner. And all the Google services like Hangouts and Google Now are at the forefront. For example, Google Now is just a swipe away from the home screen. And you can start a search or launch applications or perform any basic activities by just saying, OK Google.
OK Google, how old is Johnny Depp?
He is 50 years old.
But this feature will only work provided you've set your dialect to US English, provided your screen is on and you're at the home screen, and that you're not using a third-party launcher. I think that is a lot of conditions for a simple feature like voice command to work. Now, one thing I really liked about KitKat is the new dialer. If you don't have a certain contact saved on your phone, you could just search for it, and it will get you relevant results from your surroundings. For example, when I search for Domino's, it gets me the nearest Domino's outlet from my place, and I can straight away make a call right from there. Also, when you receive calls from a number that Google has a record of, it will show you the contact name with a relevant image. Apart from that, Google Hangouts is now the default app for all your text messages. I found this to be really convenient because it helps me organize all my conversations in one place, but I do think they should have more notifications. Because right now there's only one notification for both Hangouts and SMS, so there's no way of telling which one you've received unless you pull down the notification drawer. Another beautiful feature on Android KitKat is the immersive mode, which allows apps to utilize the entire screen real estate. So the user interface does not get in your way while reading a book or watching a movie. I feel this, along with the 4.95-inch screen, makes the Nexus 5 a very suitable device for entertainment. Also, when a song is playing, you get a full screen view of the album art on your lock screen. This looks quite beautiful in my opinion, and it's good to see that Google is finally paying attention towards aesthetics and not just functionality. So for those of you who care about benchmark results, I have run a couple of tests. So here's the Geekbench score, and I ran a 3D rendering test on GFX Bench, and I could not notice any frame drops whatsoever, and the animation was quite fluid and smooth. I thought of putting the GPU to a real-world test. So right now the Nexus 5 is rendering this 3D model live and motion tracking it using the iPad as a reference. This takes up a lot of processing, and you can see the Nexus 5 is doing a very good job. There is no delay in motion tracking at all, and I could not notice any frame drops. This also translates quite well while gaming. There were no glitches while playing some of the most graphic-intensive games, but the device did heat up quite a lot. Chrome is again the default browser with the Nexus 5. It has improved quite a lot since Jelly Bean. Websites load much faster, and text practically takes no time to render while zooming in or out.
So if you were out in the market buying a new device today, would I recommend the Nexus 5? Definitely yes. It does have its pros and cons. Talking of the cons first, number one, the camera app is not up to the mark. It takes time to focus and it's kind of laggy at the moment, but that may get fixed with an update. Number two, speaker. The speaker isn't really that loud and it tends to distort if you push the volume all the way up. Also, the placement is really odd because if you're holding the phone in landscape mode, you tend to block the speaker. And that's really bad if you're playing games or watching videos. Number three is the battery life. The battery life is not bad, but it's not great either. You can get a day's worth of juice with moderate usage, but that's about it. Number four is storage. You are limited by either 16 or 32 GBs, which is still better than Nexus 4, which only had 8 and 16 GB variants, but the power users among you might still find this limiting. We saw Google giving away 50 GBs of Google Drive space with the Moto G, which you will not get with the Nexus 5. And this is really disappointing because this is a flagship phone that we are talking about here. But I still think all of these cons don't weigh up to the merits of the phone. With the Nexus 5, you get more than what you pay for. You get top of the line specs without having to burn a hole through your pockets. At $349 and $399 for 16 and 32 GB variants, this phone is a total steal. Also, you get to taste the latest flavor of Android. The Nexus 5 is obviously the first phone to be shipping out with Android KitKat, and other Google Edition phones like the HTC One and Galaxy S4 are getting the updates now. But that's not it. Whenever Google comes out with a new update for Android, you will be the first one to receive it, at least for the coming 1 year or so. So that's really great in my opinion. So all in all, I think the Nexus 5 is a very solid device, and I would totally recommend it to anyone buying a smartphone today. And I've tried to cover as many things as possible in this review, but if there's anything that I left out on, do let me know in the comment section below. So that pretty much wraps up the video, guys. I have got a couple of app reviews coming up soon, so stay tuned for that. And I'll see you next time. Have a good one.